Welcome back once again to Discussion-Based Teaching Explained, a channel dedicated to discussion-based classrooms on which I will discuss how to teach and learn in a discussion-based environment. I'm Adam, I'm a teacher, and I've been developing a discussion-based teaching practice now for 18 years. And though it's still very much a work in progress on this channel, I hope to share some practices and beliefs I've found successful over the years. Let's just do a quick review of where we've been so far. The first 7 episodes of Discussion-Based Teaching Explained focused on discussion philosophy. Then, in the last episodes, number 8 to 18, I focused on how to spend that first third of class for the first third of the year. In other words, how to discussion skill build. So let me say 2 things about all these discussion skill building exercises. They're awesome and they're exhausting. Long story short, you can't really do these exercises every day. You've got to mix it up a little bit. So starting in about the 3rd or 4th week, I mix in kind of a special discussion exercise experience, maybe every other week. So 2 great ways of doing discussion without actually having a discussion are debates and simulations. So in this episode, I'm going to talk about 3 great ways to crush debates. And in the next episode, I'm going to talk about simulations. So first, let me start with a reflection question. How do you feel about debate? What role does it play, if any, in your classroom? I try to deploy debate judiciously, but still in a way that serves discussion. So let me say a little bit about debates. The truth is I'm a little trepidatious about debates for a few reasons. One is that one of the main killers of good discussion is certitude. And debates actually encourage certitude. And that's mostly because in some ways I think debate is the opposite of discussion. Another thing is that debates invite kids to kind of argue and not listen. And the third thing is, like, kind of debates encourage kids to create this artificially airtight intellectual vessel and, like, defend it from all oncoming ideas. But I feel that done right and delineated clearly as kind of a separate space and followed by some really good debrief time, debates can really actually serve discussion. But I would say for sure, make sure you know why you're doing it and make sure they know why they're doing it. So all that said, here are 3 great ways to crush debates. I'm going to kind of present them in order of how intense and time-consuming they are, starting with like the simplest and going to the most complex. So the first one requires almost no movement or setup or specialized homework. I call it the declaring debate. This is a really simple exercise in which you have students respond to a statement you've created, which is based on a text or a video or on some data that you've presented. The statement very simply has to be definitive. So maybe it's something like, cities are more civilized than small towns if you're teaching early ancient world history. Or maybe it's something like, the revolutionary era patriots were terrorists if you're teaching AP US history. The students begin the declaring debate with a focused free write in which they respond to the prompt, but they start their focused free write with one of 4 expressions, strongly agree, disagree, or strongly disagree. What I like to do is actually have them declare their stance by positioning something on their desk that everyone has, like I use a textbook. So for example, strongly agree is cover up book vertical. Agree is cover up book horizontal. Disagree is cover down book horizontal. And strongly disagree is cover down book vertical. In this way, they're kind of putting their opinion out there without having to do it verbally, but kind of everyone's book is kind of sitting on their desk. And it's especially good for beginning discussants. You can even have the students change their book position as their opinion changes, or you could check in with them and say, does anyone want to change their book position? And then the physical movement of the book becomes kind of like an announcement. And by you deliberately organizing a moment for them to reflect on their stance and given the opportunity and even the encouragement to change their stance, that's a really important message. Another approach I use to crush debates is a little bit of a step up in intensity and deliberation, but it also requires no specialized homework, and that is called the percentage debate. The percentage debate can be done really based on anything they've read previously in class and can be done within a class period. As with the declaring debate, for the percentage debate, you do need a statement that they can agree or disagree with. So let's say it's the one I mentioned earlier, the revolutionary era patriots or terrorists. So like in the declaring debate, I had them start with a focused free write in which they take a stand. But rather than limit their stand to one of those four areas like in the declaring debate, I have them declare a percentage. So the more they agree with the statement, the higher percentage they get. However, I do not let them put 0%, 50%, or 100%. This is more conceptually driving home the notion that you should always have a little bit of doubt, so you can't be at 0%, and a little bit of doubt on the other end, so you can't be 100%, and that you can't be exactly split in the middle. Then I ask the students to actually get up and rearrange themselves according to their declared percentage. Sometimes I'll even do this with the group standing in a circle. So basically, they've arranged themselves in a circle of agreement and disagreement. Important safety note here, I recommend, rather than arranging your room like this, that you arrange it like this. The reason for this is because you want the people at the most extreme ends sitting far away from each other. So really what you don't want is the 1% and the 99% sitting right next to each other, because then all the action is kind of in that one space. Once everyone is situated, there's a lot of options. I mean, you could just let them go and see what happens. Sometimes I like to ask students to explain why they are where they are. I generally want to hear from everyone, or at least from a representative from each quadrant, before we launch into kind of a live debate. That said, no matter how you start, I think it's a good idea to tell the students before you start that there's going to be kind of like a halftime or round two, at which point they'll be asked to kind of reassess where they are. I think it's also a good idea for this halftime or prior to round two for them to return to their journals and add to the writing that they did before they had heard the discourse. The percentage debate obviously allows for more shades of gray different than the four declared debate positions. And you'll see students going from 70% to 85%, or from 55% down to 49%. And obviously what really matters is the intellectual flexibility that students are showing by taking in new ideas. Back in episode 12, I talked about the reflective equilibrium. This was kind of a discussion of intellectual dynamism and kind of the internal tension that goes on for discussants. And the percentage debate is kind of metaphorically a perfect place to see this, right? They establish their fulcrum during their focused rewrite in the beginning. They decide where to position themselves percentage-wise. And then they hear different things that maybe pull them this way, and it swings over here. And so they get to reposition their fulcrum. Okay, so last but definitely not least, the third way I try to crush debates is through a formal debate. The formal debate is a whole different beast for three reasons. Number one is you need to dedicate a homework assignment to debate prep. Two, there is a lot of timing involved during the debate. And three, there are specific speaking roles involved. One of the main benefits of a formal debate that I like is that though you're definitely breaking from the discussion format, you also have the opportunity to put certain students strategically into certain speaking roles that you think will challenge them. There are like 8 steps for setting up a formal debate as far as I'm concerned. First of all, choose a topic and make a statement that has a lot of intellectual room on both sides. So like in AP US history, one of my earliest debates is to look at the 1790s and they have to either defend the Federalists or the Democratic Republicans. Second, you have to have them prepare the debate at home for homework. So in their debate prep notes, I have them create a column of broad arguments in support of their side. Then in the next column, I like them to create counterarguments to their own arguments. And then in the third column, I like them to rebut the counterarguments to their own arguments. So it kind of looks like this on the assignment sheet. And this is how it would look in a student's journal. As you can see here in the first column are the broad arguments. Then in the second column are some opposition arguments. And finally in the third column, a rebuttal to the opposition arguments. The third step is that I'll go into class beforehand and I'll assign the roles. It's usually things that they don't naturally do in discussion. Fourth is when the students come in, I will take time to explain the structure of the debate and to explain each role, especially the first time. So honestly, once they've done the debate 2 times or maybe 3 times, it can really be done in an hour because they know the structure and they know the roles. But the first time they do it, I plan on it taking like an extra 15 or 20 minutes. So let me take you through the debate introduction and instructions that I give them before the debate the first time they do it. So when they first come in, I have them sit in 2 circles, the believe on one side and the doubt on another side. Then I draw this diagram on the board, which I'm going to walk you through right now. And during this time, I explain each phase of the debate, each role in the debate, and what that role player should be doing during the prep time. So the first phase of the debate is the prep phase, and this usually lasts around 10 minutes. And as I'm setting up the debate, I will definitely tell all the students, depending on their role, how they should be spending their prep time. The second phase of the debate, which is indicated with the Roman numeral 2 in red there, is the believe side opening. Now, this is usually done by two students, and their job is to present their side's argument using three broad arguments, BAs. And they also have to bring a lot of evidence in support of those broad arguments. So where they go to get those broad arguments are to either of their notes, but they're also sitting with all the other members of their team. And so usually what the two believe openers will do is use maybe one person's broad arguments or maybe a hybrid. And once they do start the debate, that'll last about 4 minutes. And I'll be timing them with note cards. Then we move down to Roman numeral 3, phase 3 of the debate. And this is where the doubt side will immediately cross-examine the believe side. This cross-examine is done by two students on the doubt side. And their job during their prep time is to prepare about 5 questions, kind of think of them as lines of questions that they're going to immediately interrogate what the believe side said during their opening. However, one of the twists in this debate format is that the two students who opened will not be the two students who are responding to the doubt side's cross-examination. So there'll be two other students on the believe side who will be responding to those questions. So during the prep time, while the two believe openers are preparing their three broad arguments, two other students, knowing that they're going to be cross-examined on those ideas, have to be working with the believe openers and sitting on the believe side with them on their team, getting ready to be cross-examined. And that's really a tough job. Phase 4 of the debate, oh, by the way, the doubt crossing the believes lasts about 6 minutes. Phase 4 of the debate continues within the doubt side opening. Again, two students, three broad arguments, using evidence. Again, 4 minutes. Then we go to phase 5 of the debate, which is the believe side then cross-examining the doubt side. Again, two students during their prep time, they're creating their 5 questions. And when they do take the floor for 6 minutes, they're going to be cross-examining two other students, not the two students who opened for the doubt side. And now we're getting towards the end of the debate. Phase 6 of the debate is one person from the believe side closing the debate by summarizing their side's strongest argument and maybe highlighting the other side's weakest arguments. And then I usually like to encourage them to kind of close with some kind of spicy nugget or a quotation or something that we hadn't heard before. That usually lasts around 2 minutes, and then we go to phase 7 of the debate, where someone on the doubt side will close, usually one student. Again, summary, spicy nugget. Then I usually let them go for at least a little bit of time into an open debate format with no rules, no roles. They keep their sides, but they basically can kind of just argue with each other. And then I shut things down with a debrief. They are released both from their roles and from their sides. And we're talking conceptually about the debate topic, but we're also talking metacognitively about how the debate went. So a couple things I wanted to emphasize about this that I wrote is deciding who gets what roles is a really important part of the debate. If you're going to do this, then you really want to deploy students in roles that are challenging for them and maybe in roles that they aren't normally playing during discussion. And that's another thing about this debate is that there's a lot of flexibility. So this is the way I drew it out here is designed for about 14 students. If you have more students, sometimes I like to use captains and have one person on each team have a non-speaking role, but their job becomes just kind of coaching everyone up. I usually will reserve that for one of my stronger students. And the nice thing about this debate also, as I said, is that there's different phases. There's more formal speaking. There's kind of extemporaneous responding. And the last thing I want to say about this debate is I used to do it so that it was the believe would open and then the doubt would open. But in this debate format, I like it much better because the believe opens and then the doubt gets to immediately cross-examine them. So it's fresh in everyone's mind what the believe just said, and there's quite a bit more tension and interaction, and then the same thing happens when the doubt side opens. Well, that's it on debates. and I consider it kind of a special day, like a non-discussion day in which I hope that a lot of our discussion skills and dispositions are still prevalent. In the next episode, I'm going to explain another special day, simulations. Thanks for tuning in to Discussion-Based Teaching Explained. Again, I'm Adam. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please email me at discussionbasedteaching@gmail.com, and thanks for watching.